Greetings, beautiful co-creators, brave and kind earthlings. Thank you for joining me for this episode of the Authentic Action Podcast. I'm super excited about this episode because it is the first after a very long pause of more than 6 months. I paused for personal grieving and adjustments to the new paradigm that we all find ourselves in. I feel I've been preparing for such a shift most of my life, and yet still it has taken some getting used to. Unexpected twists and turns abound, even as they are all in line with predictions and logical expectations. I am pleased to be getting back into the swing of things gently with this friendly conversation about the warrior spirit with a longtime friend of mine who I feel embodies this spirit very well in his own unique way. He has held high standing amidst his fellow reenactment warriors in the SCA and also overcome personal challenges to continue to set an inspiring example of how to be an upstanding person, human, man, and warrior. I hope you will enjoy this casual conversation as we explore a little bit of his own personal journey. And so without further ado, I introduce to you the infamous Black Duke himself, Mr. John Knapp.
Here with John Knapp. Welcome to the Authentic Action Podcast. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
And just in the spirit of authenticity, I'm going to mention that this is a repeat. We've tried this conversation before, so there may be some things that we talk about that seem like we already talked about them, but we're going to roll through those at whatever pace we feel like. And just have a nice conversation. The main theme being creating a life that you love for yourself. So, and subtext to that, I still like to talk to you about the warrior spirit in general, because I should have said earlier, your AKA is the Black Duke, and I know that fighting is a huge part of your life, and so I feel like you embody that warrior spirit in much of what you do. Part what I was just checking out on your Facebook page was your basic night stuff little video clips, which were very entertaining. You got a little comedian in you there.
Right.
That was cool. So maybe you want to talk a little about that.
Let's see. Basic night stuff was a thing that came out of the stay in place COVID pandemic situation.
Uh-huh.
So there's within the club that I'm involved in, the SCA, there are levels of participation, and one of them is a knighthood. And so somebody made a funny video, and then after that, it kind of caught on. And the video itself didn't go viral, but the whole process kind of went viral.
So there are many others. I'll have to look into that.
Some of them were pretty good. They're really.
I thought yours, but yours made me giggle. That was
right. It's always the ending.
Yeah.
And that was done in one take with my phone battery on about like maybe 8%. And I set up a few little stations and had my Mexican buddy Jesus run around and film me as I was doing this. So it was quite funny.
Cool.
As far as the warrior spirit, I like medieval fighting, and I do that in the SCA, and I'm fairly good at it. I've trained a lot of other people to be good at it, and I enjoy the single combat tournaments all the way up to the melee warring scenarios.
Mm-hmm. And we talked a little about it before, but give us a synopsis of how you came to be a fighter in the SCA, which, by the way, stands for Society for Creative Anachronism.
Right.
Which is a reenactment group.
So my origin story for that group would be that my dad was in the military, and he, after being in Germany, all of us as a family, we moved back to the States, and he retired in El Paso, Texas. Excuse me. We moved back to El Paso, Texas, where he retired, and then he went into college on the GI Bill, and he graduated as a teacher. But along the way, he met this one man, Stan Bernheim, who was a He was an interesting fellow. He was a master in the SCA, and he's been playing for a long, long time. And he had convinced and talked my dad into coming to check it out. Mm-hmm. And my dad did. And then he got the rest of us to go with him as a family unit. And so that was when I was about 15 years old. I would say I was like a freshman or eighth grade, something like that. So then we went to a few of those events, and then I went to a camp out war with my dad, and there was some melees and stuff that happened, and I was a combat archer, and I had to get together a suit of armor and a bow and some arrows and get ready for that event, and it was great. It was fun. We had it at a place called Burrow Creek in California, and that's what it kind of opened my eyes up a lot more to the SCA and what that was about. So after that, I turned 16 and I got into the heavy weapons fighting, and that's full contact, wearing medieval armor, unchoreographed. And so I liked that even more. And then within about 2 years or so, fighting regularly, I got to be fairly good, and I entered a competition to be the Prince of the Islands, and I lost that. But then 6 months later, I won it, and that was by the time I was 18. So, and I served my time. I did the rain, and I entered another tournament, which was going to be for King of the Islands, and that was the second crown tournament, as the principality had become a kingdom, and I won that one. And then I, about a year and a half later or so, I entered again, and I won that, and then I became a duke. And let's see, I like to wear a lot of black in my armor and my costumes, and so there was a melee situation here in Albuquerque between this guy, Artan, and myself, and he was the white duke, and I was the black duke, and then we had to gain our army, Sam, and then we had a big battle, and I won, but he had become, won the crown tournament list that year, and he was about to become King of the Islands anyway. So I was the Black Duke, and I did some little uprising and kind of whooped up on the Crown Prince of the Islands, which was a bad thing to do. So they kind of nicknamed me the Black Duke, and they kind of stuck.
Right. Kind of embracing that villain.
Oh, yes.
Mentality or aspect of yourself.
Sure.
And
it's better to be hated than ignored.
Right. So they say, yeah. Seems to be popular. I don't think you're hated, though.
No.
last time we talked, you told a little bit of the history, because I asked you about when you thought, like, when you remembered that warrior spirit really coming into you, and it went back even further than the SCA, like, to grade school.
That's true. I grew up except for being in Germany, I spent most of my time in El Paso, Texas. And the school that I graduated from, or the area, the district I graduated from, went from school to school, was like the second oldest district in El Paso, Texas. And me having red hair, I stuck out like a sore thumb. And so I got into quite a few scuffles. And
were you super tall back then, too?
Oh, hell no. No. I was just a fairly fast, skinny little kid. I mean,
right.
And so you got to be fast, or you can learn to fight, or both. So, anyways, but yeah, I got into a lot of fights either for myself or my brothers. And, you know, cause sometimes there'd be like more than one. And so you have to even up the odds a little bit. And, but yeah, I give you, like I said, either you're going to eat shit or you're going to fight, you know, mm-hmm. until the authorities get there. So anyways, learn to fight.
Cool. And I know I asked you before and you said, no, there were like no favorite other influences outside the SCA. Is that still true?
As far as fighting goes.
Or that warrior spirit.
Like, the warrior spirit.
Yeah.
Outside of the SC, no, because when I was a kid, I mean, I liked sports and stuff, but I didn't really like fighting or the boxing or anything like that.
Right.
So I would still say no, but once I did get into the SCA, there was quite a few influences that made me want to be better or how to get better. And so.
Do you remember any specific incidences that inspired you?
Yeah, we had this guy in El Paso. He doesn't play SCA very much anymore, but he was his name was Van Patzel, and his SCA name was Van of the Skilled Hands. Mm-hmm. And he was, he was a EMT, paramedic, and he also was a bouncer at bars, and he rode bulls when the opportunity was and they came to town. He also wore a mask and he'd go fight in Mexico or wrestle in Mexico. And so he was pretty violent, some martial arts and stuff. Okay. So he was a pretty violent guy and a pretty nice guy though. You know, you definitely did not want to get into a fight with this guy, but right. I mean, and he was nice all the time too. So anyways, yeah, he'd run people's face into the wall and then patch him up because he was an EMT after that. Right. Or for cops get there. Anyways, crazy guy. But yeah, he was a very good fighter and he showed me a lot of things. And most of it was through an induction of pain or and get better or enjoy the pain.
Right.
You know, so, fighting him between ages of 16 and 18 really prepped me for some of the bigger guys that are in the club. I mean, big Vikings and, you know, those kind of guys.
Right.
So, having somebody at that skill level, for myself being a young age, just really just made all my other senses better. Mm-hmm. And then after when I was 20, I moved up to Albuquerque. And because Albuquerque was known as the fighter town, you know, it had a lot of big, huge fighter practices and stuff. Right. Many guys, 50 to 75 guys. And so I moved up to where the fighting was going to be a lot better for the type of fighting that I did. And I was here for about a year. I kind of like dominated this place to where the Baron gave me the fighting award and stuff like that. And I've never really left because I liked fighting here.
Yeah. You were well loved and feared all at the same time, in a way.
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah, there's a lot to be said for a nice guy that knows how to fight but doesn't want to.
Right.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I mentioned before to me that embodies the warrior spirit. I have some martial arts background, and so the idea that like you would be able to win but you wouldn't need to appeals to me, even though I know that's not how the SCA works. But I like that idea of being a badass but not needing to prove it necessarily.
Yeah, you really don't want to ever have to.
Right.
Which has also helped me because I'm 6'2", and a lot of times, or I was 6'3". I'm getting old now, but people don't tend to pick on guys that are bigger than them.
Yeah.
So that worked out pretty well.
And you are an infamous hard heavy hitter. I had the pleasure of being hit by you a couple of times. So right. You don't forget that.
No, I'm sure. And then in the fighting that we do, is if you got us. A successful shot or a series of shots.
I should mention with a stick, like you weren't just punching me in the face, but in armor. Correct. For those correct. Who don't already know
right.
how the SCA works.
Yeah, you were on a playing field being treated like an equal.
Right. Yeah, I appreciated that. You were somebody who actually, you know, hit me hard. Not didn't treat me like a girl, but I mean, maybe you did a little bit, but mostly I felt like, yeah, you hit me hard, which I appreciate.
Yeah, when you hit somebody, you want your opponent to acknowledge it, mm-hmm. have no doubt that they're it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, and you had a famous leg shot, which I've mentioned before. I felt my bone bend a little bit. So.
Right. There's two sides to a sword, and the front side is a itch in the thigh, and if you switch it around to the back side of the sword, I was known for hitting people in the butt.
Yeah, you probably got me in the butt too, but my butt's well padded, so right. My leg's well padded too, it's still flexed. But I actually had a really heavy stick that was like, that I used to call John, named after you, that was just right. Like, I couldn't really wield it because it was too heavy for my arm, but I just, you know, you just pick it up and let it drop on somebody, and it was making it thump. So.
Right. Yeah, I did use probably one of the bigger sticks.
Mm-hmm. Cool. What else would you like to talk about? I know you have a favorite story from being in the SCA, or maybe more than one favorite story.
You talked about what having a happy life and what makes a happy life.
Yeah, creating your own life, you know, on your own terms.
Yeah, so I felt like that follows in line with my fighting story, because when I was 20, I moved up here, and I'm still here at 54. Mm-hmm. And so I felt like I found my comfort zone as far as fighting goes, and I like the state and stuff like that. And so I bought a house out in the country, out in the county south, and I've lived there for like the last 20 years. So.
And you got your, suddenly the name escapes me. You got your certification, your license for
building houses and buildings. Yeah. Right. The GB98, basically a contractor's license. Mm-hmm. And, I remodeled homes, and I've built some commercial office buildings for a while.
What comes to mind now? I've asked you this before, but maybe you have the same answer or a different answer. What comes to mind as your favorite or some of your favorite buildings that you built?
Oh, let's see. There is there's a big three-story building down at Broadway and Lead, and that's the Forestry Service building. And that one's really, really nice building, very clean, all the nice angles. There's a place called, let's see, I forgot the name of it again, and I had already thought about it since then.
Right, I can't think of it either. You've
mentioned it before. It's, oh, well, let's just skip over that.
Yeah, you just talked about the building.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a small takeoff of a Taj Mahal type of building. Mm-hmm. Tribal Arts is the name of that building.
That's right.
And it's got some Turkish domes in it, and they sell a lot of rugs and stuff like that. But I built that building, and right as I was quitting my commercial construction job and getting my license and stuff, and those guys that were actually really nice to me, and they hired me to build some specialty carts and hand railings and stuff like that, welding, and so right off the bat I had work going. Yeah. And that's a really neat building.
Was that the only building like that that you?
It's the only one in Albuquerque. It's the only one in Albuquerque like that.
Right.
Yeah, that has a Middle Eastern influence.
Mm-hmm. And you don't see much of that here.
No. Those guys are really good guys. They're Pakistani businessmen, basically. Mm-hmm. But they're good businessmen. That one's another one that I like that I've built. And, gosh, what's the other one? And the other ones are kind of, you know, basic buildings, whether they're shopping centers or office buildings, you know. Mm-hmm. They're pretty basic.
Yeah, so your life now, with regards to creating a life that you love, you live with your parents still? I mean, not still, but like
now. Oh, yeah, no, I never moved under their wing. I'm a big mama boy. No, that's a lie. No, I have my own house, actually.
Oh, but I mean, close to them.
I have a house that's about a mile away from my folks so that I can help take care of them in their aging.
Nice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And what do you mostly spend your days doing these days?
Well, I do a lot of I do a lot of outdoor stuff. I still train in my backyard, and right now I'm painting a friend's house that lives in Cerrillos, a little town outside of Santa Fe, New Mexico, and then I do gardening and stuff in my house, and then also work. Do gardening at my folks' house. We put in a pretty big garden this year, and we had all kinds of different vegetables. And let's see, what else do I do? Not enough. That's all work stuff. I want more play stuff.
So. Yeah. You mentioned before that you were that you wish that you were making time for playing an instrument. Is that still on your list?
Yeah, that's on the bucket list, right? For sure. Have I done it yet? No.
Yeah, when are you going to start?
I don't know. I've been watching your videos too much, you know. I see your band practice all the time. I don't know exactly. Right now, my focus is to try to get a little bit more healthy and get back into fighting.
Yeah. So I don't know if you want to talk about your rounds with health and come back kind of from struggling.
Yeah, it was about 40.
An accident or two, and then something
else, so. About 48 or so. I got into an accident that I got T-boned. Excuse me, I got T-boned in my truck and by Mustang. I was going at a high rate of speed, and I almost died. You know, they said it, but I walked away from it. And I mean, I think I was stunned. I think I had a concussion, but
okay. Might have been staggering away from it.
They asked if I had anything to drink and stuff, and I was like, oh no. And then, so that took a big bite out of me for a little bit. And then I had, a thyroid issue, which was really, really, really weird, because it took a lot of the strength in my neck muscles and took those away. And so I had to go see some specialists and figured out what was wrong with me, get on some medication, and I'm able to lift my head up again. So it was almost tragic. I mean, it was painful, embarrassing, all kinds of crazy stuff. Let's see. Oh, and then I had my knee totally replaced from sports injuries, mm-hmm. and I've got a torn ACL in the other one, but that was an old issue. And I had my gallbladder taken out just here this past year. I mean, it's like, once it's 48, it's like everything started. Like, okay, this one you're not going to be able to use it anymore. This one here, replace it. This one here, let's go. Let's start checking this one out and following up. You know,
right.
I feel like I walked out of a mechanic shop, you know, to some extent.
I reflected a lot on your answer to one of my questions last time about wishing there wasn't disease. And I was thinking, in a lot of ways, yeah, and I mean, disease, like, some disease seems like just hits people, especially when they're young. Certainly don't want to belittle that. But the majority of problems that we face, like, in our 40s and 50s, seem like you can kind of see a clear. I mean, of course, getting hit by another driver is not something that you can trace back to your own behavior, usually.
Oh, yeah, but, there's nothing like seeing a car at full pace right there.
Right.
I mean, that within a feet, 1 foot of you.
Right. But that I'm going to chalk up as injury, different from disease, where disease is often seem to be the price we pay for the lifestyle that we've had, you know,
or genetic.
Yeah, that too. So I guess I'm wondering if any of those experiences, like you felt like you called on that warrior spirit to cope with or get through. Or it was family. I knew your family's been
most
supportive.
Yeah. You know, and I'd say that, you know, if you get to a low point and a down point, and it's like, okay, well, what the hell else are you going to do? You got to keep going, keep fighting. And really, that's just the core of it all. I mean, my brother died and stuff, and it was really horrible to watch him fighting death off, and just within the last 2 weeks to a month, watching digress at a faster pace was pretty horrible. And which was also one of my ailments for a while. My head was ailing. I was crazy.
Yeah.
And
grief or depression is grief is.
Yeah, but talking about things helps. Mm-hmm. That's for sure. It's a fact. You just got to be able to say fuck it and open up.
Yeah.
Take a chance, mm-hmm. you know, and but back to it, what else can you do? Keep going on,
right?
You know, there's just too many other people that look up to you or look at you, and then you would be failing them if you just gave up or ended your own life or stay depressed or just quit trying, you know. Mm-hmm. And there's people out there that do that. So, anyways, fight till you die, fuck it.
Yeah. I like it. I've thought about giving up a time or two, but I feel like like you said, I think it's such a disappointment when people that you know and love do give up, that it's
right.
In a weird way, I've been grateful for the people who have committed suicide in my life, because they've really drove that lesson home to me. Like, it's so devastating to
others
around them.
Yeah, you're really hurting everybody. You're gone right there in an instant, but everybody else has to live with you being gone.
Yeah.
So it's just like, how much pain are you going to bring to everybody else?
Mm-hmm.
You ain't caring, son of a bitch.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
Well, we can get into my three questions part of the interview, which is if you had a magic genie bottle with three wishes, and one of those wishes had to be for yourself, and one of them had to be for humanity at large, and one of them could be for anything at all that you wanted, what would those be?
I think that,
I'm going to move this too, while you
okay. Let's see. I think for humanity, I would wish that, that there was no hunger and education was free. How about that, Sue? I mean, because it's all possible to do.
Yeah, that is. I mean, you don't need a magic genie bottle to make that happen, really. But maybe you do, because humans see.
There's a lot of other people. That. I mean, you have one view of it. You have one small pair of eyes looking out into the whole world, and where there's like thousands of other people in some other country that are all suffering, don't even know what. They're struggling so bad, they don't even know what's good, you know, or
right.
What's bad. I'll take that bad, you know? So there's a lot of other people out there who are suffering. And, you know, water is becoming more and more of an issue as the planet gets full,
mm-hmm.
Stuff like that. You know, right now, I think man is eating more fish than the fish can replace in themselves. And so, like they say, about 2050, which is only another 30 years or so, there won't be any fishes.
Yeah, if we don't change our ways.
Yeah. Yeah. So... those two are realistic wishes, mm-hmm. You know, but they don't get done because somewhere along the line, somebody's got to have too much more money than somebody else. And that's usually the basis for fucking it all up. So let's see, what were the other two wishes?
One has to be for you personally, and the other can be whatever you want it to be for.
Okay. So for myself, let's see. I wish that I didn't have to wear glasses for my whole life.
Hmm.
How about that one? Yeah, that would have been great. So I haven't worn glasses since I was like 4 or 5 years old.
Hmm.
And so I think that would be a cool thing to have, like 20/20 vision, or which is still a possibility, maybe,
right.
Or getting closer to.
Yeah, like coming up with some neat technology. Yeah. I just had to start wearing glasses, and I can admit that I felt smug for the majority of my life that I had such great 2015 vision, and now mm-hmm. It does really suck.
Yeah, 2015 is when you can see better even farther away.
Yeah, because I still have better far vision than close, but
right.
But yeah, I could, and I still see fairly well at night and things, but mm-hmm. Yeah, I used to just not understand what it was to not be able to see, because I could see everything. And now I can't read what's in front of my face without glasses.
Right. I mean, it's like things are just fuzzy. And
then, you know, you got the reflection thing and
right,
so many
right.
issues with it.
Yeah. Let's see. I think that...
you talked about freedom before, but...
Yeah, no, I'm okay with that.
Yeah,
I mean, there's, you know, the thing about those wishes is that there's a good side and a bad side to everything you wish for.
Of course, yeah.
You know, and then let's see how kind of crazy we can get with it.
That's, yeah, I mean,
you know, so,
that's probably why we don't have a magic genie with wishes.
Right. I think that I would probably pass on my third wish or save it.
Yeah, just put it in your pocket. Huh?
Save it for a rainy day.
Huh.
You know. Nothing wrong with that. Keeping the genie in the bottle. have a wish for me to still spend.
You just have an infinite, knowing that you had a special wish would be your wish.
That's right.
It's a nice one. I like it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's nothing wrong with saving a little.
Right. But then you might frivolously use it up when you were intoxicated one night or something. Something that you regretted later.
I doubt I would regret it. But perhaps you're saying I would possibly use it without thinking, you know. I take that to believe that it could be in either some sort of anger issues, or that could be in some sort of lustful issues or whatever, but certainly that's a possibility, but I don't think that would be me.
Right.
Although, you know, when you add alcohol to the whole trick, then sometimes you can believe things that aren't necessarily true.
Right.
You know, so I guess you are subject to be taken advantage of or something like that. If you're under the influence.
Yeah, I don't know about too. I mean, that's true too. But also we don't moderate ourselves as well when we're intoxicated. So that's generally what gets us in trouble. Sometimes people taking advantage, but usually it's us messing ourselves.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you know, it lowers inhibitions, but doesn't necessarily change your thoughts.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't been drinking this year, and it's been interesting. I actually find that I'm just as susceptible to a lot of things as I was when I was drinking. So I don't know that it made that big a difference. I mean, I'm sure it did. From the outside, probably made a bigger difference. Mm. I can still be an ass or, you know, gullible, all those things that drinking brought. Drinking just gives you an excuse for why you were that way.
For why your senses are heightened.
Why you made the mistake. Now it's like, what's your excuse?
Well, that's it. It may not even be a mistake.
Right.
No.
I guess that's my point is like, I still make similar choices as I did mm-hmm. when I was drinking. When I'm drinking.
So. Right. So let's be drinking.
Yeah, my body just doesn't like it as well. That's why I give it a rest, trying to heal up and, you know, figure out something I can eliminate. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm not stating that I'm quit forever. It's just taking a break to see,
you know, sure.
to see if I can heal up. So. Mm-hmm. And so far, I like it. So.
You can deal with it or without it.
But like I mentioned with wearing glasses, it's really interesting that about like without glasses is very similar to getting inebriated for me now as far as my vision. So it's like
absolutely
just blurry eyed all the time. So.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. You know, eyesight is definitely one of those senses that you want to keep as long as you can.
Mm-hmm.
So
I just saw a cool thing on some new technology. It's a wristband, and it's made for people hard of hearing originally, where it translates vibrations into words in your mind, basically. But you can program it to translate all kinds of different wavelengths, including infrared, microwave, mm-hmm. and basically create new senses in the body. I'm pretty excited about it. I mean,
wouldn't that be something?
It's here. It's like I heard him talking about it a couple years ago, and now you can buy the wristband for $100 and the little extra thing that can make it sense infrared or microwave for another $26. So I mean, it is accessible.
Yeah,
it's pretty cool. Yeah, but they don't have one yet for just regular vision, but I'm sure that's right around the corner.
Wow, so I mean, like Star Trek instead of the visor, you didn't have Star Trek with the wristbands.
Yeah, originally it was going to be a vest, and again, it was created the intention to help people who are deaf hear through their body.
Mm-hmm.
They found the vest was not doable cost-wise, and they found that your brain is so amazing that just the vibration coming through on your skin on a wristband is enough after a month or two for your brain to acquire the ability to.
I'm sure it senses pitches, like, you know, in the form of a question or a statement.
Yeah, they said when you first put it on, you definitely be able to recognize your own name and things that are familiar to you, but like to listen to a whole audiobook was the example they used. That might take you a few months of your brain adjusting to it, you know.
So if you wore this thing when you're not having problems, though, Does that mean all of a sudden you will be relying on this thing more and then your other senses start to dull?
Well, that was exactly one of the questions posed, and it was interesting. The guy, the neuroscientist who was involved in creating it, has clearly been, you know, he's gotten hooked up for infrared, and he's like, you can look at a bench and see where people have been sitting, you know, because you see the heat signatures coming off, as some other animals already do. But but I did notice in the interview that I just watched with him in it, that he seemed like he was not using his eyes the same way. I've watched many interviews with this guy over the few years. And so he was saying there's no evidence yet, you know, but I was just looking at him thinking, I don't know, there might be evidence right there. Really. It's hard to say. But so far, what we know about the brain in the neuroscience field is that it is way more capable than we generally give it credit for. And so probably you could add at least 3, maybe 6 extra senses for your brain to process before you start to lose, you know, other thing. That notion that like there's only so much you can fit in the brain has so far been proven not to be true.
Oh, that's crazy.
Because we build, so your senses actually build on each other. Mm-hmm. And so
we're probably waiting too long as far as they putting our kids in school or hooking them up with some sort of education.
We've
focus.
All heard of some kids that have gotten so much input when they're young and then they're like super geniuses, and that's
right.
Because it's not a limited thing. Like, we're not doing nearly as much with our brain as it's capable of doing.
So I would think so.
It's pretty exciting stuff. So yeah, I would think that even that technology is probably capable of enhancing our vision. Clearly being able to see in infrared is already pretty cool. Like, that's an enhancement.
But you know, it makes sense in the whole evolutionary type idea. You know, at first we were like hunters and gatherers violent fucking apes. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And then to get to the point where we're doing a lot more things with our minds.
Yeah. Well, they talked about how, like in a car, you do kind of embody, once you know how to drive, you really extend your awareness into that vehicle, which is one of the reasons I love driving. And I used to do Tai Chi sword form, and that's kind of the same idea. You're extending your awareness into the sword. I mean, you've probably done that with stick fighting. And, I think this wristband is just an extension of that kind of idea, where you're bringing in though new kinds of information, and then the brain is quickly learning how to incorporate that into your awareness.
Yeah,
pretty cool stuff.
And unwrap and put in place, categorize.
But back to your wishes, I really do like the idea of just having like a wish in your pocket. I feel that way a lot in my life. I know that I believe in the quantum universe. Like, there's so much more that we don't know than we do know. And so I think I walk around a lot of the time.
You could be on my deathbed. I'm on 50 more years.
Right.
You know, or something.
Now, yeah.
Right. I want a do-over.
Which, I mean, far as we know, maybe we do just start over. I don't know, but
yeah,
my mom believes in reincarnation, so I was raised with that belief system. So that would be the basic idea, that you start over. Although that same neuroscientist that I was just watching was asked about brain plasticity, and the guy interviewing him was saying, like, could I just like make my brain more plastic, like a child's is, where you can learn so much faster? And he was saying, not really without losing your identity, same as, you know, being reborn, kind of same idea. Basically, if your brain, because our brains get harder as we hardwire our experiences in. And so it becomes, you know, it seems like it's harder to learn new things, but that's because we're sure about things, and we identify, we make these stories that create our identity of who, our idea of who we are. And if you make the brain plastic again, like a young person's is, more, then you have less of an idea of who you are, really.
Of course.
So yeah, I don't know that we really need any genies in the bottle ultimately. Like, it's a pretty amazing universe that really does in a lot of ways give us exactly what we wish and hope for when we're willing to.
What we need.
Yeah. I don't know about what we need, but I go the other way. Right. You get what you want, but not what you need. No, I think, you know, what you focus on, whether it's what you need or want, or what you don't need or want, really, is kind of how I see it. But Right. That's just my personal philosophy. And a lot of people would disagree with me on that. So.
No.
No.
Yeah, I think that you get what you like, what you pursue, like you say. Yeah. And that's a good one.
And what you put your energy toward.
Yeah.
Some people do put their energy toward what they don't want, and then it seems like you can get more of what you don't want. I don't think the universe really believes us with our want, don't want. It just says, here's where you're focused, here's what you're going to see, basically.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, I guess we could wrap it up there.
Okay.
Is there anything else that you want to talk about? Any other stories that come to mind that you want to tell? Or,
no, not really.
Right.
I mean, I've got tons of them, but I don't want to bore anybody or go on a tangent or, you know, be more than I am, you know.
Okay. So, how would you sum up the warrior spirit in a quick soundbite kind of way, in a sentence or two?
Be open to learning. Trust your skills, your trainings. Never give up.
I like it. All right. Well, thanks for joining me again.
Thank you.
That concludes this episode of the Authentic Action Podcast. I hope you enjoyed our brief exploration of what it means to live a creative life with a warrior spirit. I feel like we could have dove a lot deeper into several aspects of this conversation, but I'm glad we got our feet a little wet, and I look forward to picking up momentum in the coming months and years. As always, I thank you for listening, and I welcome your questions and comments if you care to share any. Also, if you're thinking about starting your own podcast, check out Buzzsprout. I will include an affiliate link in the description. And if you end up signing up from that link, you will get a $20 Amazon card, and you'll also be helping to support this show, which I appreciate immensely. Many thanks, and don't forget to play every day. Peace.